In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, welcome to worship this evening. And a few announcements as we begin. I am Pastor Richard Jorgensen, and Pastor Janice is continuing her recovery at home. She does hope to be here tomorrow for the congregational meeting, so I would name that, and I hope that you will be here tomorrow morning for the congregational meeting. And I will add, it's an important meeting here. We're looking at the future of Zion and looking at what is it that God is calling us into in this coming year. And it will be a big year. Some other things which I'll lift up for you. And one is a confession, you know, that as a preacher, I've got to tell you, there are times when you look at the texts and you say, I could go here, I could go there. So tonight I will be preaching on 1 Thessalonians. Tomorrow I will be preaching on the gospel text. So if you hear the gospel today and you say, hey, I have questions, come back tomorrow, just so you know. And I will give you one final observation as we begin worship together today. The oldest book of the Bible, as far as we can tell, is the book of Job, which may be about 2,000 years old, which means it predates everything else in terms of when it was written. And the oldest book of the New Testament is in all likelihood 1 Thessalonians. And why do I name this? If you think of what are the questions that are in the book of Job, and you think of questions about suffering, and death, and why, and notice that becomes the first written book of Scripture. The first letter of Paul to the Thessalonians is meant to address similar questions. So hold on to these thoughts. I will invite us now to rise as we begin our worship together. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, abounding in steadfast love toward us, healing the sick and raising the dead, showering us with every good gift. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Just and gracious God, we come to you for healing and life. Our sins hurt others and diminish us. We confess them to you. Our lives bear the scars of sin. We bring these also to you. Show us your mercy, O God. Bind up our wounds. Forgive us our sins and free us to love for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And the Apostle Paul writes that when we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive together with Christ, healing the record of our sins to the cross. Our Lord Jesus says that your sins are forgiven. Now be at peace and tell everyone how much God has done for you. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Righteous God, our merciful Master, you own the earth and all its peoples, and you give us all that we have. Inspire us to serve you with justice and wisdom, and prepare us for the joy of the day of your coming, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Our first reading is from Zephaniah. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice. He has consecrated his guests. At that time, I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the people who rest complacently on their dregs. Those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do harm. Their wealth shall be plundered, and their houses laid to waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The warrior cries aloud there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring such distress upon people that they shall walk like the blind, because they have sinned against the Lord. Their blood shall be poured out like dust, and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath. In the fire of his passion, the whole earth shall be consumed, for a full and terrible end he will make of all the inhabitants of the earth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We now read the psalm of today, which will be read responsibly. Lord, you have been our refuge from one generation to another.
Before the mountains were brought forth, where the land and the earth were born, from age to age you are God.
You turn us back to the dust and say, turn back, O children of earth. You sweep them away like a dream. They fade away suddenly like the grass.
In the morning it is green and flourishes. In the evening it is dried up and withered.
For we are consumed by your anger. We are afraid because of your wrath.
Our iniquities you have set before you. Our secret sins are the light of your countenance.
When you are angry, all our days are gone. We bring our years to an end like a sigh.
The span of our lives is 7 years, perhaps in strength even 80. Yet the sum of them is but labor and sorrow, for they pass away quickly and we are gone.
Who regards the power of your wrath? Who rightly fears your indignation? A second reading with 1 Thessalonians. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief, for you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep at night and those who are drunk get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please rise.
As we welcome the gospel. This is the Holy Gospel as written for us by St. Matthew, the 25th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
And Jesus says, "For it is as if a man, going on a journey, summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with 2 talents also came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents, and see, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? And you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return, I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.' And this is the good news of our Lord."
Praise to you, O Christ.
And please be seated. By the way, I want to notice, you know, when you all say, yeah, good news, right? And it is good news. So you have to come back tomorrow and hear why. But let me unpack something for you. As we prepare to dive in, can I ask, did any of you ever name a car? Yeah. So how many of you named a car? Raise your hand. Okay, we have, by the way, so this must be the car naming corner. And so what did you name your car?
Betty.
Beatrice. Not only is it the naming car corner, but naming cars Betty and Beatrice.
Baby.
That is impressive. Anyone else? But you did. Periwinkle. Very cool. And I will share, I named a car, but only once did I ever name a car. And that may or may not have anything to do with the sermon, but we'll pray. And gracious God, bless us as we ponder your word, that your word may take root in our hearts and in our lives, that your word would challenge us, change us, transform us, make us anew, O God, to be the people we are really meant to be. In Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen. So here it is. Back when Janice and I were in seminary, we had a gray Ford Fairmont. And by the way, does anyone remember the Ford Fairmont? And if you don't, thank God, yes. And for those of you who do remember the Ford Fairmont, we will have counseling later. So we had, you know, this Ford Fairmont. It was gray, and it was really gray. There was not, nothing in this car was shiny. It was the dullest gray in the history of the world. And this car, it had a, by the way, we named it Narcolepsy. And in case you're, of course, narcolepsy is a sleeping sickness where people are tired all the time and then they'll fall asleep in the middle of the day without warning. And that described the car. Because I would be driving this, and without warning and for no apparent reason, the car would just stop. The engine would just stop. I can't say it died. It didn't sputter. It didn't cough. It didn't gasp. It just stopped. And then I would turn the key and nothing would happen. And this would last for 30 seconds, sometimes 15 seconds, 30 seconds, 2 minutes. You never could really be sure. But it would happen, and it would happen at unexpected times. And I will add, at this point, we lived in Buffalo, New York, which in those days had 350,000 people. So I will say driving a car which for no apparent reason at various times would just stop was not very popular. You just stop. And then, then after about a minute or two, you'd turn the key and it would start as if nothing was wrong. And so we went to different mechanics saying, this is our problem. And different mechanics said, well, we can't figure out what's wrong. We don't see anything mechanically wrong with your car. And so just learn to live with it. Yes. Learn to live with the car that for no apparent reason, while you're on the interstate, just decides to stop. It's amazing the things you put up with when you're in your 20s in graduate school and broke. Finally, we found this hole in the wall garage on a back alley in Buffalo. And the mechanic there really spent time with it. And he finally came and he said, what's wrong? It's a sensor. And this was the 80s, so these things were new. There's this little chip, it's a heat sensor. And it says your car is overheated, which it never was overheated because it didn't run long enough to get warm. But this is what it was. It was this little sensor and it was defective. And the part cost 40 cents. $40 in labor. Later, we replaced the 40-cent chip, and the car ran beautifully. We were so excited that I went out and bought a brand new set of snow tires for narcolepsy, the car. And lo and behold, I felt good about life. And I parked the car and we went out to dinner. And we came home and the car was not where I parked it. So Janice goes, well, did you maybe park it somewhere else? It's like, well, I parked the car in the exact same place every evening, but we looked and, by the way, that feeling you get? The car was stolen. I finally got the thing running, and it was stolen. And so we call the police, and I have to add, this was a great moment. They go, "Was anyone murdered?" We said, "No, our car was stolen." And they said, "We'll get to it." These were the good old days, 1980s, you know what I'm saying. And the car was eventually recovered, and it had been destroyed. And the main reason they said it was stolen was because it had new snow tires in Buffalo. All that time with this car. And it was for real. A thief in the night came and took the car. So why do I share this? Of our images for Jesus. By the way, we have favorite images, don't we? Good Shepherd, Savior. We want to think of Jesus as the one who comforts us and the one who is with us always. But how often do we think of Jesus as the thief in the night who comes without warning? And you know, it was when we were celebrating, we were feeling good that the thief in the night, who was not Jesus, came and took the car. And in many ways, that's what Paul is writing today, by the way. He says, Jesus will come at an unexpected hour. Jesus will come not when we are, when we have ourselves, we are staying up all night watching. It's when we are dozing that Jesus would come unexpectedly. So why does Paul write about this? And by the way, the Thessalonians, for them, this was really good news that Jesus would come in that way. I hope it's good news for you. In spite of the image, thief in the night, I hope it's good news to you that Christ will come. Here was the challenge in the first letter to the Thessalonians. This letter was probably written maybe in the 40s AD, maybe 50, but probably 40s. So we're thinking 15, maybe 20 years since the resurrection. And the earliest Christians were expecting that Jesus would return at any moment. And so there was this church in Thessalonica. And they had received the gospel. They believed this good news. And then something happened. Members of that church started dying. By the way, they didn't die in anything dramatic. They just died of natural causes, which is what happens. If you live long enough, you die. You do understand, very few of us get out of this world alive. And that's what's happening in Thessalonica, is that people are dying. And the crisis for them is, but Jesus hasn't returned. And someone I love has died. And what does that mean for them? Does that mean that they're no longer part of what God is doing? Does it mean, because they have died, that they've missed out on the kingdom? And our old Dean Gerhard Krodel said, really, that he believed, and I trust him because he was much smarter than me. He said he believed that the real crisis was that some people were not burying their dead. Because if we bury our dead, then they're really dead, and Jesus returns, and they can't be part of what God is doing. So Paul writes this letter to assure the Thessalonians that whether we live or whether we die, whether we're alive or not, that Christ will gather us all. that death is not the last word on us. Christ has the last word. And the last word is not death, it is life. And it is that Christ's life will conquer all things, including death. And so in the meantime, Paul is urging these Thessalonians, and you know, by the way, he says things such as, we do not grieve as those who have no hope. He doesn't say that we don't grieve. We do grieve. We grieve as Christians, but we grieve with hope, and that hope will not be disappointed. So in this passage today, when Paul writes to them, it's an encouragement. Remain faithful. Christ is coming. We don't know when. And it will be unexpected as a thief in the night. But unlike a thief in the night who might take something from us, Christ comes as a thief in the night to take us to himself, that we will be with God forever. So what does it look like in the meantime, you and I? I will add, I've had folks say to me, well, you know, I really don't want Jesus to return because I have other plans. You realize that's the opposite of what the Thessalonians had. I will say, just don't fall in love with your own plans more than you love God, because Jesus has the final word on us. But how do we live in the meantime? And I always love, John the 23rd was asked, you know, what would you do if you knew Jesus would return tomorrow? What would you tell, you know, the people here in Vatican City? What would you tell the church? He said, I would tell everyone, look really busy, which I always liked. You know, by the way, it was good advice. Look busy, but don't just look busy. Be engaged in God's work. And Martin Luther, by the way, this probably never really happened, but the legend is Luther was asked, if you knew Christ would return tomorrow, what would you do? And according to legend, he said, I would plant a tree. And I will add, he probably never happened, but I love the story because it was, if we know Christ will come tomorrow, let us still live as if God's future will come in God's time. So how do we live in this season? I would like to say that we ought to live in hope. This is a season, by the way, fear and anxiety are contagious. And we live in a fearful time and an anxious time. But I would also hope that you notice that hope is also contagious. And I want us to live as people of hope in this season. And not just me. God wants us to live as people of hope. God wants us to live as people who are filled with love, who love God, who love one another, and who love this world which God has made. And I would hope that in this season, that we will live boldly as disciples of Jesus. The Lord will come like a thief in the night. So let's get busy. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please rise as you are able for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us turn our hearts to God, our breath and life, as we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Gracious God, you give talents and gifts to all your people, and you equip the church to serve. Turn us from fear and self-serving ways, that we use our talents to glorify you and encourage our neighbor. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You have been our dwelling place from one generation to another. Sustain the life of the planet. Protect farmlands and harvests. Direct all people in wise stewardship of all the earth's resources. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You call us to honesty and integrity. Instill these values in the hearts of all nations and their leaders. Free any who are oppressed. Expose all corruption and bring redemption to victims of injustice. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You teach us to count our days, that we may gain a wise heart. Where there is sickness or sorrow, bring healing. And where there is loneliness, reveal your love in community. We remember before you all those on our prayer list. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for the faith formation ministries of our church. Give to all children, youth, and adults who study your word the breastplate of faith and love. Shape us by your love and show us how to encourage one another. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious God, you are faithful in all generations. For the promise of life and rest and for the witness of those who have died in faith, we praise your goodness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We offer our spoken prayers and those held in our hearts, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
My dear friends, may the peace of our Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace.
We worship now with our tithes and offerings presented to the glory of God.
Please stand for prayer and our service of Holy Communion. Let us pray. God of all goodness, generations have turned to you, gathered around your table and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them that as we gather these gifts from your abundance and give thanks for your rich blessings, we may feast upon your very self and care for all that you have made through Jesus Christ, our sovereign and servant. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, our bread of life, our table and our food, you created a world in which all might be satisfied by your abundance. You dined with Abraham and Sarah, promising them life, and you fed your people Israel with manna from heaven. You sent your Son to eat with sinners and to become food for the world. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life given for us and his rising from the grave, we await his coming again to share with us the everlasting feast. And by your Holy Spirit, nurture and sustain us with this meal. Strengthen us to serve all who are in hunger and want, and by this bread and cup, make of us the body of your Son. Through him all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. And Lord, remember us in your kingdom. Teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus is the host of this meal. We are all guests at his table. If you feel unworthy, unrighteous, unready, know that Christ died for the unworthy, the unrighteous, the unready. He died for us. Come to God's banquet, for all is now ready.
body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
And the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen.
The body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen.
May this, the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. And so a few words as we look forward to these coming weeks. By the way, just as an aside, totally strange, if you wonder why I move this back and forth, trifocals. And this side sees better than this side. Isn't that just great? We live long enough, these things happen. The good news is I can still read the book. So things I'd want to lift up. I've already announced that we have the congregational meeting tomorrow. Worship tomorrow. We have one service, 9 a.m. The meeting follows. Tomorrow we will have preparation of college care packages, and also just really want to point you, if you've not picked up the announcement sheets, a bunch of wonderful things coming. And next Sunday is Christ the King Sunday, which is the last day of the current church year, and then we launch the first Sunday in Advent, a new church year, the first weekend in December. And for anyone who's just wondering, this past year that we've been living into is a year of Matthew. Next year we move into a year of Mark. If you want, you know, if it helps you prepare spiritually, you may want to read Mark's gospel these next couple weeks just to get the overall flow of where we're going. And by the way, spoiler alert, God wins. I will add also, we will have decorating of the church on November 29th, which I believe is something like 2 weeks. Oh. Wednesday, yeah, November 29th, yeah, Wednesday a week. And also the poinsettia sale. So everything you have is here. I will probably mess it up if I stay any longer with it. I will remind you the Advent books are available. Please do take at least one for yourself and perhaps one to share, and many folks have contributed. So if there are no other announcements at this time, because I've mangled them all anyway, I invite you to rise as together we will have a word of blessing. We will depart in song. And now may the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And may the God of all grace bless you now and forever. Amen.